Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. Great to be with you again. Thanks so much for joining us here this Sunday morning. I might look a little more red depending on the lighting. It's not the lighting. My wife and I were gone this last week, as some of you know, to celebrate our 30th wedding anniversary. So, it was awesome. We were able to get away to this warm little island called Aruba, and it was 85 degrees, not to make any of you envious or anything like that, but coming back and it was like 50 degree shift, right? So actually, I really like the cold weather, so it was a warm welcome, a good welcome for me coming back. But yeah, so I got a little bit more of a red face. I don't usually tan too much. It's sort of burn and peel is kind of the approach that I take as a guy, unfortunately, but that's the way it is. But it's good to be back. It was great to be away. Good to be back as well. Thanks so much for all of you who have prayed for us for safety and travel and all those things like that. Now, I noticed when I came back, it's hard not to notice that we have two things that are really interesting out on the front lawn of the church. We have one thing that said we have a sign that says deeply rooted current sermon series, and then we have this like vivid illustration of a tree that's fallen over on our front yard. Did you notice that when you came in today? And I thought to myself, well, all right, so is this some sort of like illustration for us supposed to be? This is what happens, you see, when our lives are not deeply rooted, right? This is what happens. The winds blow and the thing blew over. A bird probably landed on that thing is what happened, because that thing was ready to go with just a flick of a finger, I'm sure. But it's so interesting we think about this, and I just couldn't help but sort of see the irony of all of that. I took it really as an illustration of what happens if you don't be deeply rooted, rather than an indictment on us that we're not, right? Because we are deeply rooted, and we're going to continue to pursue that as God's people here. Now, over the last several weeks, just to give you a quick recap of where we've come from in this series, in week number one, we talked about what it means to be deeply rooted based upon Colossians chapter 2, verse 6 and 7, where Paul said, "Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith." That text tells us that you start by receiving Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, and then from that point on, it's all about being rooted and built up and established in the faith. And so this entire series has focused upon that, to say, listen, I've come to know Jesus Christ. He's my Savior. He's my Lord. How do I go deeper? And really the starting point of that in message number one was all about restoring kind of the romance, is the title of the message. Maybe you look back at several weeks ago now and you remember, oh yeah, that was the message from Revelation chapter 2, where Jesus said to the church of Ephesus, I have so many great things to commend about you, but there's this one thing you've left for your forsaken your first love. And it was a call by Jesus to that church to say, listen, sometimes along the spiritual journey as followers of Jesus Christ, we can go into a place of a little bit of familiarity, maybe too much familiarity about our faith. And we lose sometimes sort of the desire that God has for us, that we would desire him so intently, so deeply, so passionately, that zeal and those kind of things that we maybe once had in our lives somehow dissipate. And the message was a call to say, that's the starting point, really, of going deeper, isn't it? We have to have those religious affections stirred in us once again. God, do that in me again, please. The second message was just entitled Going Deeper, and it was all about, so you can have the desire, right? You can have the desire to go deeper. You can have the desire for God, but there's also certain things that we have to do in order to sort of create the kind of place or the space for God to work in our lives. We talked about how we have to eliminate hurry from our lives, how we have to sometimes reorder our priorities and look at sort of our lives as if they're a sheet of paper with a margin on it and say, what are we doing with margin? Do we have any margin in our lives at all for us to spend time with God? And then we talked about hitting the spiritual gym, but training yourself, as Paul told Timothy, train yourself to be godly. And then we dove into a message entitled Deeper with the Word, where we looked at David's incredible desire for the Word of God in Psalm 119, how he desired it, he delighted in it, how he meditated upon it. And it was an encouragement and a call to say, Lord, help me to go deeper in your word, not just in knowledge, but that I would actually meet you in the word, that I want to have an encounter with the living God in his living word. And then last week, while I was gone, thankful to Larry Geisler, who came and he preached about being deeper in prayer from Matthew chapter 6. And that brings us to this morning. This morning's message, we shift a little bit to talk about what it means to go deeper with the Spirit of God, to go deeper with the Spirit. Now, to do that, it's important that we understand who the Holy Spirit is. And so that's where we're going to start this morning. Who is the Holy Spirit? And not only who he is, but what does the Holy Spirit do? And it's impossible, absolutely impossible, to encapsulate all that the Holy Spirit does in one single message. And so we're just going to give you this morning some sort of high points about the work of the Spirit in our lives to help us to go deeper. And so first of all, though, I want to begin in your notes, if you're following along, I want you and I to understand, first of all, the Holy Spirit is a person. The Holy Spirit is a person. It's important to understand the Holy Spirit as a person because if we don't see him as a person, we end up seeing him kind of like a lot of different cults that exist out there today see the Holy Spirit. They see the Holy Spirit as just sort of like a force, like an active force even, they'll describe it, some sort of power or sort of energy that emanates from God, but that's it. But when we say person, we have to ask, what do we mean by that? What do we mean when we say that the Holy Spirit is a person? Well, it's important to understand that not all persons have physical bodies, and not all persons are human. Now, track with me a little bit on this. Typically, when we hear the word person, we think of a human person, don't we? We think of a human person, and that is correct. We, as human beings, are persons. But the truth of the matter is that even biblically, there are other categories of persons. For example, God is a person. But John 4:24 tells us that God is spirit and that he's not a man. He's not a human person, but nonetheless, he is a person. Angels, for example, are persons, but though they can take on physical bodies, by nature, they don't have a human body. They may manifest themselves in a human form or they have angelic bodies. For this reason, it's correct to say this, that all humans are persons, but not all persons are human. All humans are persons, but not all persons are human. And this is true of the Holy Spirit as well. The Holy Spirit is, by very nature of the name, a spirit, invisible, and yet the Holy Spirit is still a person. Now, what constitutes a person? What is it that makes up a person? Not the human person, but a person, period. Well, for example, we can see this about the Holy Spirit to be true. We can see that the Holy Spirit has personal characteristics. He hears and speaks. He testifies. He can be grieved. He can be lied to. And we'll look at some of these in the passages in front of us. He also has personal pronouns that are ascribed to him by those who wrote the New Testament, in particular, the Apostle John. And for this reason, we should actually never refer to the Holy Spirit as it. We actually really need to erase that from any vocabulary of ours. When we talk about the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit is not an it. The Holy Spirit is always referred to in the personal pronoun, he. And John and other New Testament writers gave those masculine pronouns to the Holy Spirit, even though the word for spirit in Greek is neuter. Neuter. It didn't have gender affixed to it, but the New Testament authors gave personality to the Holy Spirit by referring to the Holy Spirit as him or he or himself. So we can see all of this, for example, in John chapter 16, when Jesus taught his disciples in the upper room, starting in verse 13 and 14, he said, when the Spirit of truth comes, notice carefully what it says here, he will guide you into all the truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you all the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. Notice how many times in this short passage, in these two verses, the Holy Spirit's referred to as a he, personalized. You see, John wants you and I to understand that the Holy Spirit isn't just this active force The Holy Spirit shouldn't be referred to as it. The Holy Spirit is a person. I also want you to notice what it says about the Holy Spirit in here. The things that the Holy Spirit actually does that show us that the Holy Spirit must be a person. Required that the Holy Spirit is a person. Notice it says when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak. So now the Spirit speaks. He hears. He declares to you the things that are to come. You see, that which is sort of a force or some sort of power source that's not personal, that's depersonalized, does not have the capacity to declare to you the things that are to come, that is, to predict the future. And he also will glorify Jesus. That can't be said of anything other than that which actually possesses personality. And he will take what is mine and he's going to declare it to you. He's going to declare it to us as followers of Jesus. So what we see in this first section, in order for us to actually walk with the Spirit and live by the Spirit and to go deeper in terms of our relationship with the Spirit, it's actually critical that we understand who he is, right? I mean, we know this fundamentally to be true whenever we think about and talk about God, period, don't we? When we talk about God in any shape or form, you have to know who God is in order to worship him correctly. We grow in our knowledge and understanding of who God is. The more that I know my wife, the more our relationship is stronger. The less I know, the less better off it is, right? This is true for every single relationship. We need to know and understand in order to really sort of have the kind of depth of relationship that is ours in Christ. So that's the first thing that I want you to know about the Holy Spirit, is that the Holy Spirit is a person, not to be confused with a physical human being. The Holy Spirit is not a human person, but nonetheless, the Holy Spirit has personal characteristics. Secondly, I want you to understand that the Holy Spirit is God. The Holy Spirit is God. Now, the Bible teaches that there is only one true God who exists as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's the doctrine of the Trinity. And we don't have the time this morning, of course, to go into full-on teaching of what the Bible teaches about the doctrine of the Trinity. I'd love to do that sometime. I have done 7 or 8 weeks on the doctrine of the Trinity as a pastor in the past. That's not the time and place for do it now, just to simply say that in summation, that's what the Bible teaches. The Bible is very clear that there is only one true God, one true and living God, one true being, and that one being that we call God exists simultaneously as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And now we often hear, and rightly so, that the Father is God. We often even will hear that the Son is God, that Jesus is God. But rarely, because conversations don't really happen too much about the Holy Spirit at times, depending on what church you're kind of a part of, we don't often hear about the Holy Spirit, and especially we don't hear about his personality, that is who he is, as a person, and that he's actually God. So what we see in Scripture is this, that there's one true and living God, and that one true and living God, we call it the Godhead, we call it the Trinity. We refer to him scripturally as Yahweh, right? In the Old Testament, it's the four Hebrew letters that were constituted as the Tetragrammaton, out of which we have inserted vowels because it was unpronounceable by the Hebrews or by us. And so we've inserted vowels into that name of God, and we've come up with Yahweh. It's really not something we can actually pronounce. It's YHWH. So our best attempt at the name of God is that he's Yahweh. Well, Yahweh is the one true and living God. And this one being consists of three personalities, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Now, that's not exactly the easiest thing to wrap our mind around. That's why someday we'll do another message on the Trinity itself. But I want you to see in Scripture where this comes from in terms of how the Holy Spirit is actually referred to as God. There's an account in the book of Acts in chapter 5, verses 1 through 4. It's an account from the early church where Ananias and Sapphira, a couple in the early church, decided that they were going to sell a piece of land that rightfully belonged to them. It was their land, and they could do with it whatever they actually wanted to do. The problem is that they sold the land, and they gave the impression that they're giving all the proceeds of the land to the church, and they didn't actually do that. They actually lied and misrepresented what they were doing. And here's this sort of really sort of a, boy, what a challenging text. You read this, and you kind of think, boy, how does this not create sort of fear among the people of God to sort of do what pleases the Lord? Here's the text how it reads. But a man named Ananias with his wife Sapphira sold a piece of property, and with his wife's knowledge, he kept back for himself some of the proceeds and brought only part of it and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and to keep back for yourself part of the proceeds of the land? Now, just to point out again here in talking about the personality of the Holy Spirit, you can't lie to something, technically you can't lie to something that's not a person. I mean, that's just impossible. I've gone the rounds with different religious groups, cults that exist that try to depersonalize the Holy Spirit, that try to deny the doctrine of the Trinity, and we come to passages like this, and I say, how is it possible to lie to the Holy Spirit if the Holy Spirit's just an active force, just power, just sort of the source that emanates or comes from the Father, but that's it? Like electricity, something that you plug in. Can you lie to electricity? And they would say, well, you can lie to the electric company. And I said, that's a different thing altogether. You're talking about lying to people now, aren't you? Organization with has people in it. So here the Holy Spirit is specifically lied to by Ananias and Sapphira. In verse 4, it says, while it remained unsold, did it not remain your own? And after it was sold, was it not at your disposal? Of course it is. This is their property. They could do with it what they want. Why is it, though, that you have contrived this deed in your heart? You have not lied to man, but to God. You've not lied to men, but to God. You see, what Luke is doing here is he's saying to us, if you lie to the Holy Spirit, what are you doing? You're actually lying to God himself. You see, because that's what we know to be true in terms of there being one true and living God, Yahweh, and that one true living God is Father, Son, and Spirit. If you lie to the Spirit, you are lying to God. If you lie to Jesus, you are lying to God. If you lie to the Father, you are lying to God. Additionally, there are a ton of attributes of Scripture, attributes, sort of these character traits of God that only God possesses, that we do not possess, that the Holy Spirit also shares. The Bible tells us, for example, that he's eternal or that he's omniscient, meaning that he's knows absolutely everything, or he's omnipresent, that he's absolutely everywhere present, Psalm 139. He's all-powerful or omnipotent, and on and on. Whatever attributes the Father possesses, the Spirit possesses, and the Son possesses, because one God, they all have the same attributes, they all possess the same attributes in terms of these divine attributes that are not shared by humanity. So what we've seen so far is that the Holy Spirit is not just some force or impersonal power, but rather he is God. And this becomes particularly important as we move forward in this message and as we ask the second key question, and that is this: how does the Holy Spirit help us spiritually? You see, because we're not talking about a force. We're not talking about power or electricity. We're talking about how does God the Spirit actually help us spiritually? How does he actually help us to go deeper? How does he help us to become more deeply rooted? We know that the Father does things in our lives. We know that the Son does things in our lives. But the Spirit also has a role in our lives to take us deeper. There's six key areas that I want to highlight for you this morning. First of all, he is described as another comforter. He's described in Scripture as another comforter. Jesus gave this depiction of the Holy Spirit in John 14, verse 6, or 14, verse 16, when he said, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper," or another comforter, some translations will have it, "to be with you forever." So in Greek, this word that's here, this word for helper, the word helper that you can see on the screen in front of you, is actually the word that can also be translated as helper or comforter or counselor or even advocate. It's a word parakletos, which means one who comes alongside. So the Holy Spirit here, we're told by Jesus, is going to be given to us. He is another helper. He's another comforter or another counselor or another advocate. And if you think about advocate, think about it in some respects, even in a legal sense. If you think of this one passage where it's used elsewhere in the New Testament, it's in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. It says of Jesus, but we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. It's the exact same word, parakletos. You see, Jesus is our advocate in the sense that he's actually our advocate with the Father, so that when we sin, he says in 1 John 2, if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one, meaning that Jesus is there in heaven, in glory, before the Father, so that when we sin, our advocate, that is Jesus, is there in our defense. It's like saying we have a defense attorney before the Father, who will slam down the gavel and say he's innocent or she's innocent because of me. So Jesus is that for us, but also the Holy Spirit is this for us, Jesus says. The Holy Spirit comes alongside you and me. He comes alongside of us. Now, when did all of this happen? Well, at the time when Jesus said this to his disciples, they didn't have the Holy Spirit's presence among them in the same way that we have it afterwards. You see, after the death of Jesus, his burial, his resurrection, Jesus ascended into heaven. And from heaven, what happened? He sent the person of the Holy Spirit to be with us in the journey of life, in our spiritual journey. So the Spirit now has come upon the church in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. That's when it all started. And he walks alongside each and every one of us. As your counselor, as your comforter, as your advocate, as your helper, as you go through this seriously challenging terrain called life. To know that we are not alone. We're not alone. We have the Spirit in the text that we've read to guide us, to speak to us, to walk with us, to teach us, to lead us. This is what John 14 through 16 tells us, and many other places. This is the role of the Spirit. He wants to be the one who walks alongside, and he is that in your life. So let's not ignore him. The second way the Holy Spirit helps us spiritually is by actually living inside of us. So not only does he come alongside of us, but he also lives inside of us. We can see, secondly, that he is not just with us, but he's actually in us. You see, there's a difference between being with and being in, and Jesus brings this out for us in the New Testament. For example, by way of contrast, in the passage that's just going to be in front of you in a moment, in John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, there is a contrast that's being made by Jesus between the current situation of the disciples and all that was before, and what would happen in the future when the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit certainly was active. He was there already at the very beginning at creation. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was formless and void, and the Spirit of God was hovering, right? The Spirit of God was already there from already in the creation account, already in eternity past. The Holy Spirit's presence is all through the Old Testament. There's no question about it. It's all over the Word of God. But there's something unique and different that happened. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come upon people, but not upon everybody. And the Holy Spirit never indwelt, that is, lived inside people permanently in the Old Testament. What you'd find in the Old Testament is that the Spirit of God would actually come upon individuals, manifesting something for a season, for a period of time, and then the Spirit of God would depart, and they'd be left without the Spirit. All of this changed with Jesus. We can see this in John 14, 16, and 17, where Jesus said, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him." I mean, frankly, if Jesus is referring to the Holy Spirit in personal ways, how could we not refer to the Spirit in personal ways? He refers to the Spirit in this text as the helper, as personal pronouns. And then notice in verse 17 what he says, "You know him, for he dwells with you." That's what he's saying to the disciples, not to you and I. Not to you and I. He's saying that to his disciples because things have changed. Things have changed. He dwells with you, disciples, and will be in you. You see the shift. It's the shift from the Old Testament sort of way where the Spirit of God worked and manifested his presence amongst God's people to the New Testament time when Jesus ascended into heaven and the Holy Spirit came down in Acts chapter 2. And in that very moment when the church was born, and in that very moment the Spirit of God descended upon the earth and the Spirit of God came and lived and dwelt inside every believer, every single follower of Jesus Christ. That is an incredible truth, friends. That you and I have the Spirit of the living God inside us. Romans chapter 8, verse 9 tells us these words. It says, "You, however, are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if, in fact, the Spirit of God dwells in you." Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. I want you to notice what Paul says about the work of the Spirit in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. He says to the church, "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God." This next phrase is important. By whom, notice how personal that is, by whom, not by it, but by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. You know, I remember Trina used to do canning. Anybody do canning in here anymore? Or you just go and buy all your jams and stuff. So remember the canning stuff? I remember growing up, my mom and I, she would take us out periodically, and we would go up in Canada. We would go raspberry picking, I think it was, or something like that. And you know, you get a bucket and you just pick all as many raspberries as you could, and then my mom would make jam out of the raspberry jam. And back in that day, it was like some sort of wax seal. They're like, they get the jam and they just pour this wax onto the top of it, I think, and then they put the lid on. There was some sort of piece of paper in there somewhere. I don't remember all the details, but that sealed it. That was like kind of it. I was like, okay. And the thing would sit on the shelf until Christ came back, which was, you know, still hasn't come. And so I don't think any of those cans are still around. Or when Trina would can too, you know, there's that rubber seal, and then I don't know, there's like this big pot, and you stick it all in there, and it seems like it could all explode to me when it's being made, so you stay out of the kitchen. But nonetheless, these things go on the shelf, and they're sitting there forever, and you can still take them off. Now, I'm super sort of suspect of all that stuff. I'm a date kind of looking guy, so like if I look at a carton of anything and it's like due the next day, I'm like, ugh, I don't know, a sour cream could be bad. Or like the milk container, oh, I don't know, that's like it's due today. And then Trina usually is like, "Well, Cory, like you really?" Like, so just overnight all of a sudden it just like transforms, right? Like it hits midnight and I'm like, yeah, that's exactly what happens. You know that's exactly what happens. So I'm not touching it. I've had those times years ago where the milk was a little too overdue and I poured it out into a bowl of cereal and it was just chunks. I ain't going there. But the idea of a seal, you see, you think about the seal and how long that preserves and how it keeps it, or you think of the seal on an envelope where there would have been an impress on a seal and a stamp that it would have pressed in that wax that nobody would be able to open that. The only one who could ever open that was the king when he received the envelope. It's these kind of images of the seal that's referred to. Or you were sealed for the day of redemption. You see, this is a powerful truth from God's word for us to understand. This one text, not just this text, but this text speaks to you and I about our security as followers of Jesus. We don't only have the Holy Spirit coming alongside of us as our helper, as our comforter, as our counselor, as our advocate, as our defender. We also have the Holy Spirit living inside of us, and not just for a little bit, not just for a little while, and not that we have to have fear that, oh my goodness, the Holy Spirit's going to hit the road when he just finds out that what I just did. Friends, that doesn't happen. You're sealed for the day of redemption. You and I have a security in Jesus that is brought to us by the Holy Spirit. We are eternally secure. And that's a weight for us to consider. So in this life, that you and I live, God himself has come to indwell his people through the person of the Holy Spirit. He is our Parakletos, the one who comes alongside, who lives inside, who guides and speaks and declares and predicts and convicts and comforts and defends and so much more in our lives. The third way that the Holy Spirit helps us spiritually is that he fills and empowers us to live the Christian life. He fills and empowers us to live the Christian life. You mean there's more? Yeah, there's more. Not only does it come alongside, but he also lives inside. But in his living inside, he actually fills you. You can be filled with the Holy Spirit. He gives you the power to live the Christian life. So often, so easy for us to live or attempt to live the Christian life by our own power and by our own strength, and we just can't do it. And yet it's so easy to keep running there. But the Word of God tells us that the Holy Spirit fills and empowers us. And specifically, there's more than this, but there's really three truths about the filling of the Holy Spirit that I want to bring out to you this morning. What does that mean when we talk about the filling of the Holy Spirit? It's not like you're going to get more of the Holy Spirit, like you can get more of a person inside of you. Like I got his toe. Well, first of all, he doesn't have a body, right? I got his right shoulder, or right shoulder. No, because the Holy Spirit doesn't have a body, so it's not like you're going to get more of the person inside of you. It's not that. We're talking about more of what? The filling. We're talking about his power. We're talking about the kind of things in his life that sort of spill over into ours that enable us to actually live the kind of life that he wants us to live. So I want to give you these three truths about the filling of the Holy Spirit. First of all, his filling gives us the power to serve him. You know, we can serve God in our own flesh. We can serve him in our own strength, and that's easy to be done, although it's not very effective and not very fun. But what we want to do is live by the power of the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit, and through that filling, serve Christ. Now, sometimes as you look through a number of scriptures that I provided for you, I think in your notes, maybe I put them in there, scripture indicates that sometimes the filling of the Holy Spirit is seen and manifested in miraculous ways, and in signs and in wonders, and in tongues and in prophecy and other things like that. But other times, the Holy Spirit manifests himself primarily in giving you and I boldness and courage to speak for Christ, to witness for Christ. That it's not done from our own strength and our own power, but rather it comes from him. Before Jesus ascended into heaven and before the day of Pentecost came, he told his disciples to wait in Jerusalem for the coming of the Spirit. And he said to them in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, he said these words, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." And on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, that's exactly what happened. The Holy Spirit came down and they were all filled with the Spirit. The initial sort of manifestation of that was all speaking in foreign languages with all the people, approximately 2 million people that are gathered in Jerusalem at the time for the Feast of Pentecost. But one thing that happened was a radical transformation of one of the apostles. His name was Peter, who stood up and he preached to the people that were gathered that day, and he preached boldly, and he invited people to know Jesus Christ. And as you read through the book of Acts, and a lot of the scriptures that talk about the filling of the Spirit, it's all about this church having courage and boldness to go forward and proclaim, because that's what the Spirit does. The Spirit fills us and empowers us so that we might serve him, so that we might be witnesses for him. In and of ourselves, we'd be shaking in our boots. Even with him, we're shaking in our boots. But he gives us the power and the ability to do that. He gives us the words to say when we go out and we talk to somebody about Jesus. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that his filling impacts our relationships. You know, somebody claims to be filled full of the Spirit and yet their relationships are an absolute mess. And there's part of you kind of looking at, okay, so you're filled with the Spirit, but like when it comes to the real rub of like, living in your home with your wife and your kids, we don't see that at all. You see, that's not real filling of the Spirit, is it? I'm filled with the Spirit when I come to church on Sunday. You know, there's manifestation that happens, and I get all like warm inside and get all crazy, and I want to just bubbles up, and I just. And yet you go home, and you're what? You see, the true filling of the Spirit is not a manifestation just in some sort of an experiential way. There's some really practical ways in which the Holy Spirit fills and the purpose of His filling. Notice in Ephesians 5, 18 through 21, what Paul says. He writes to the church of Ephesus and says, "Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit." Notice the contrast between sort of wine drinking that leads to getting drunk. It's not drinking wine that's the problem. It's drinking to get drunk. But the contrast of filling yourself to the point where you get inebriated, contrasted with the filling of the Spirit in a person's life. I want you to notice in verses 19 and following how the filling of the Spirit sort of seems to manifest Himself in the filling. In what practical, tangible ways is the Spirit filling manifesting Himself in the life of the church and individuals, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. So if I'm to be sort of thinking of myself, Lord, am I filled with the Spirit? One of the sort of tests that I want to run by myself is to say, okay, Cory, are you thankful? Gee, it's that practical? Yeah. I mean that's the work of the Spirit of God, right? The manifestation of living the Spirit of God, a fullness-filled, Spirit-filled life is one that manifests itself in singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in my heart to the Lord, giving thanks for everything, and then submitting to one another, reverence for Christ, like how I treat other people. But it doesn't just stop there with Paul in Ephesians 5. If we were to read on in the context, what does he talk about next? Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church. Man, if you're not loving your wife the way Christ loved the church, or you're not even trying to, friend, I don't care how much you talk about being filled with the Spirit, you're probably not filled with the Spirit. And then he talks about wives. Wives, submit yourself to your husband. Show him respect. But it's a lot easier to do that when you have a husband that really loves you as Christ loved the church, isn't it? But it doesn't excuse you. You and I, we all have different responsibilities that God calls us to. We're not absolved just because one member in the relationship decides not to do something. Well, I don't have to do this now because they did this. No, God still says to do this. And then he goes on from there. What does he talk about? Parents with your children. You see, the filling of the Spirit rolls forward and manifests also in your treatment of your children. And in the first century context, even in terms of slaves and masters and how they would treat one another, especially if there was a Christian who was a slave in a household, or there happened to be a Christian who was one who owned slaves. And of course, please understand before you take it any further down the road in terms of slavery, we are not talking at all in a comparable way to slavery that this country's experienced. They're not the same. They're not the same in New Testament slavery. Nonetheless, it was there. But Paul calls them to elevate the way they think about these things because of Christ. Now, in the context, what's really interesting is Paul says, be filled with the Spirit. This word, be filled, in Greek, it's a command in Greek. It's an imperative. And it's actually continuous action as well, meaning that you and I are to continue to be filled with the Spirit. This is not a suggestion, it's a command. Paul's commanding us to be filled with the Spirit because he knows it's through the filling of the Spirit that actually that's how we live in relation to one another, right? That's how we actually follow Christ. That's how we live for Christ. Boy, you see the difference in big time pictured, big difference between those who try to live the Christian life in their own power and those who say, I can't live it on my own power, Lord. I am desperately in need of the Spirit of God in my life. Holy Spirit, take me deeper. Holy Spirit, I know that you come alongside me. Holy Spirit, I know that you live in me. Holy Spirit, I know that you want to fill me. And I know that right now I am probably not filled with your Spirit. And I've been trying to do this on my own. And you don't have to. The third thing is this: his filling needs to be repeated. If it was only as simple as one time filling, that's it. You're filled and you're good. Scripture actually is pretty clear that the filling of the Holy Spirit doesn't happen just once, but it's something that we need repeatedly. We need His filling because we're imperfect and sinful people who can lose the filling of the Spirit in our lives. We lose it largely through sin, right? We lose it through sin. One person once said, well, why do we need to be refilled with the Spirit? And I think the response was, because we leak. Right? We leak. Yeah, in a sense, we're leaky people. We can be filled with the Spirit, and then we can find ourselves involved in or engaging in some form of sin. And as a result of that, what happens? Like, where's the Spirit's power in our lives? Well, so what do we do then? How do we get filled with the Spirit? What's the sort of simple answer? Well, there isn't a simple answer, but I'll give you sort of three things to consider. First of all, to be filled with the Spirit, it starts first with confessing to God all known sin, doesn't it? Getting totally right with God, saying, God, I want to get everything that I know in my life. I need to get it all out before you. Second, it's a surrendering or of yielding yourself to God, saying, God, I want you to be back on the throne of my life. I want you to be in control. I want you to be the Lord, not me. And then thirdly, why not ask? Why not ask? Say, Lord, fill me with the Spirit. Fill me with your Spirit. I need your power in my life. I need your power to live. I need your power to overcome this temptation. I need your power to deal with the struggles that I'm facing. I need your power, Lord, in the ministry and the serving. I need, Lord, help. Help. And He is the helper. Jesus said it in Luke chapter 11, 13, didn't he? He said, if you then, though you're evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Our Father is a good Father. He's a good God. Ask. He's generous. All of that leads us to the fourth way that the Holy Spirit helps us spiritually. We learn that He is grieved when we sin, but convicts us so we repent. I want us to take it back to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30 for a moment. The first part of the verse we didn't pay attention to on the first go-round, but we will now. The Apostle Paul said, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. I want you to think of this sort of picture, if you will. Imagine sort of you're a canning jar. You are a canning jar. And now the inside the jar is the Holy Spirit. Maybe just put a paper dove inside the canning jar. The lid goes on, it's sealed. We're doing okay. And then we start facing temptations, we sin, we fall short of God's glory, we do things that don't please the Lord. And what happens? Well, the Holy Spirit's in us until the day of redemption, this text tells us. He's not going anywhere. So what happens? Well, if you really know the Lord, you know what happens. You feel like garbage. Don't you? If you feel absolutely like garbage. Inside you, you feel terrible. You come under conviction. You experience shame. You experience guilt. And all of that is what? It's the work of the Spirit of God. It's actually the mercy of God. It's the grace of God who's living inside of us, who will not let us go, who's making life, in a sense, miserable for us by bringing conviction to us until we confess that to Him. Because when He's in us and we sin, we grieve Him. We grieve Him. And the only way to restore and rectify that grieving relationship is by saying the thing that Scripture says, that if we confess our sins, He's faithful and righteous, and He forgives us of our sins, and He'll cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's either that response or it's this response that I've seen in individuals' lives. They know what they're doing is wrong, and that they don't want to stop, so they continue to do it. So they harden their heart against God. And the Lord is trying to get their attention more and more and more, and yet they become harder and harder and harder, and they begin to lose the capacity almost to hear what the Spirit of God is saying, because they've so, their hearts, their conscience has become seared as with a hot iron, as Paul says. Long before we ever get to that point, what we really need is to say, Lord, give me a sensitivity to your Spirit. You see, that the moment that I sin, the moment, Lord, the thought comes through my mind that, Lord, I wash those things over with the Word of God. In John 16:8, we know that the Spirit of God, when He comes, He will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. And when we're convicted, it doesn't feel very good. I remember one time years ago when I was in Bible college. Seems like a petty little thing to some people, I suppose, but it really bothered me. I thank God that my conscience was very sensitive. I worked for the president of the Bible college. I was his teaching intern, and I had access to the photocopy card. Nowadays, people are like, what's a photocopy card? But anyway, it was a card that has a certain amount of money on it, and so I could copy stuff. And I copied all like different things he wanted me to run for him, papers and different things. Well, one time I had a whole bunch of personal things I wanted to copy, and I just used his card. And I didn't think about it a lot at the time. And then I was sitting in church, and this other faculty member was up there, up preaching, and he was talking about something that really just grabbed hold of me. And the Holy Spirit spoke so clearly to me, and I just knew. I felt horrible, first of all. I felt guilt, and I felt shame. I didn't feel condemned. I felt guilt and shame, though. And I knew that I got to deal with this. I've stolen. I've stolen. And so right after chapel or church service is over, I called up Dr. Barkman, and I said, Dr. Barkman, I've got to come and see you. And he's like, well, Cory, I have a bunch of people coming over after Sunday service, and like, if you can get over here quickly. And man, I flew. Like, I must have been like about 18 years of age or something at the time. I got over there, and in tears, I confessed to him what I had done. Some people go, that's really stupid. Is it, though? No, it's not. That God would give us that kind of sensitivity to His Spirit, not just back then, but today as well. That when things happen, we address them immediately. When things may be about to happen, that we address them immediately. You see, the Spirit's not going to leave you. He's not going to abandon you, but you may find that He is in you, but He is a lot harder to hear because you don't want to hear it. What I've watched happen in people's lives over the years is that they slowly cut themselves off from the very things where they hear God. They stop reading the Bible. They stop attending church. They stop going to community groups. Because something's happened, in some sense, in some cases, where they've gotten involved in some kind of a sinful way of living. And the last place you want to be, typically, when you're involved in some kind of sinful living, is among the people of God and the presence of God. Because it's just a reminder of what you know to be true. And so the easier thing, although it's definitely the worst thing to do, is to walk away and to keep walking and harden your heart. Friends, don't let your heart be hardened by sin. Don't let it happen. Allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you and ask Him to reveal the things that you might confess, surrendering yourself to God and asking God to fill you with His Spirit. So how does the Holy Spirit help us spiritually? Well, number 5, we learn that He is the one who produces spiritual fruit in our lives. He's the one who produces the fruit, not us. We cannot be more Christ-like on our own. We can't do this. It's sort of trying to simply be moral is not the way to do it. You can't simply clean up your own life and clean up your own act. God's plan has never been that way from the beginning. We need the Holy Spirit to work in us. Notice what Paul said in Galatians 5, verses 16 through 25. He said, "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now, the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God." Now, notice the massive contrast that Paul gives in this text. But the fruit of the Spirit is... So the deeds of the flesh, or the works of the flesh in verse 19, are now contrasted in verse 22 with the fruit of the Spirit. Notice that this passage, what it does not say. This text does not say the fruit of John, or the fruit of Cory, or the fruit of Mary, or the fruit of Lucy. It doesn't say any of those things. It says it's the fruit of the Spirit. Just as the works of the flesh are the things that the flesh produces in us, so too the fruit of the Spirit are the things that the Spirit produces in us. Friends, you and I don't produce love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We don't produce that. We don't sort of, if we want to sort of look at these things, which I've done over the years, and I said to myself, boy, Lord, I could sure use a lot more joy. I could sure use a lot more love in my life. You know, let's do a Bible study on the fruit of the Spirit, and let's talk about how we can morally get better at loving people. Now, there's a place for that. But boy, if we forget that the only way that you and I could ever do that is through the power of the Spirit in us, we've missed it. We've completely missed it. You see, it's the fruit of, and here in Greek, it's a genitive, meaning it's the fruit that's produced by the Spirit. The Spirit produces the love and the joy and the peace. So that should raise the question for us, Lord, how in the world does the Spirit produce this in me? Like, how do I get these things? Great question. By trying harder, that's how you get it. No. That's actually not how you get it. You see, that's exactly the opposite, isn't it? Because that's my human effort now that I'm adding into this. So what do I need then? I need the Spirit of God. This speaks so strongly of the need for cultivating a closeness with the Spirit of God. Everything emanates, doesn't it, and flows from our connectedness to God Himself. That from the centerpiece of knowing God, desiring God, loving God, out of that comes everything else. You see, if you and I are wrong about that, what is it that we have then? We simply have a faith that's all about the intellect. But love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Everything emanates from our walk with God. The cultivation of a close walk with God, the cultivation of a closer walk with the Holy Spirit, a relationship with God's Spirit that is actually deeply rooted. So if I look at this list now and I self-evaluate and I say, okay, of these various fruits of the Spirit, what do I need to work on? Is that the right question? It's good to identify it. Well, Lord, I really need some help in these areas. I'm not at all the kind of person I want to be. So what's the answer now? Is it to drive hard after peace? Is it to drive hard after kindness? To drive hard after goodness? You see, the real first answer is to drive hard after Him. That's the first answer. That's the reality. The closer I know Him, the more I know Him. So that speak comes back to all the way back to the super basic things in our Christian life in this series about deeply rooted. Lord, am I spending time with you? Am I eliminating hurry? Am I reorganizing my priorities? Am I putting myself in your presence? Am I training myself to be a godly person? Or am I just sort of existing and running through life? Do I rarely open my Bible? Or do I open my Bible to intellectually pursue and know you in that sense, but not really know you? You see, he wants us to know him, doesn't he? It's not a magic switch we can flip. It's a journey, though, of knowing the Spirit. And then lastly, we discover that he enables us to mortify our fleshly desires. One of the things that always puzzled me in Scripture a little bit is in Colossians 3, when Paul would just simply say things like, put to death the deeds of the flesh. You're like, yeah, kill the flesh. And you're like, and then you think about it for a while, like, how? Like, how am I supposed to do that? Yeah. And you read the text, you're like, Paul doesn't say, he just says do it. I'm like, well, that's not helpful. I mean, it is helpful, but like, but like sometimes you read it and you're like, oh, that's not helpful. Okay, so like, okay, kill it. Yeah, like, that's great. Thank you for barking out an order and a command that I don't even know how to do. Of course, if you go back in the context in Colossians, you're going to discover that the way that you do it in Colossians is that you set your mind on the things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. You set your heart on the things above where Christ is seated. That's what you do. You fix your eyes upon your identity in Christ, where he has you seated and raised up and exalted with him. That's where actually your victory comes over the flesh. Paul tells us at the same time that if you want to mortify or put to death the flesh, here's what you got to do in Romans 8:13. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. If I try to willpower myself to put to death fleshly things in my life, please understand, I'm not saying that you don't ever try. We have to try. It's just, let's get the things in the proper order, right? It has to be, Lord, I need you. I need your power. I cannot do this on my own. I need the Holy Spirit in my life to work powerfully in me. So as we wrap this up this morning, there's no doubt to me in Scripture that the Holy Spirit desires to help you go deeper in your relationship with God. He's the one who comes alongside you to help you, to teach, to guide, to speak, to convict, to comfort, to counsel, to defend. He's there to, he indwells you, he's in you. He is the security of your salvation at heart. He fills and empowers you in this life to live the Christian life. He gives you all that you need to serve him. He convicts you and me when we sin so that we repent. And he gives us his mercy in that, that we could walk closely with him. And he is the one who actually gives us the capacity to produce any kind of fruit. We don't produce it, it's his. Lord, give us more love, more joy, more peace, more patience. And in that close proximity of relationship, it's through the Spirit that we're actually enabled to put to death those nasty things that we call the things of the flesh. It's my encouragement to you, church family, is to take something from this sermon. In terms of your relationship with the Spirit, you and I have a relationship not just with Jesus. We have a relationship with God, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. Let's get to know him a little bit better. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your love for us, Lord. Lord, we pray that you would help us this week to be just having an incredible sensitivity to your Holy Spirit in our lives, that we might go deeper, Lord, in our walk with you. And Holy Spirit, even this morning, maybe somehow through this morning you have convicted. Maybe there's things that are challenging in somebody's life here that they're kind of straddling the fence on. Lord, maybe today was a grace for them, a warning from your Spirit to not go on that side of the fence, but to go on the side where you are. And to make the hard calls and the tough decisions to honor you. So, Lord, I pray that you would help them to do that. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.